Welcome back. This is Brussels Economic Forum from the European Commission headquarters here at the television studios in Berlaymont. Our next session is named after Tommaso Padoa Schioppa, who we remember as a great economist and a great European. This year, the Tommaso Padoa Schioppa lecture will be delivered by someone whose contribution over the last 16 years has had a decisive impact on the EU's economy and the European Union project as a whole. Today, I'm very pleased to welcome the Federal Chancellor of Germany, Angela Merkel.
Ja, sehr geehrte Frau Kommissionspräsidentin, liebe
President of the Commission, dear Ursula von der Leyen,
sehr geehrte Damen und Herren,
ladies and gentlemen, for about 1.5 years, by now, the corona pandemic has the world in its grip, and we are all facing challenges that up to now have been unimaginable. At the beginning of the pandemic, we simply didn't have facts of how to deal with the infection, deal with the pandemic. Now, obviously, in the meantime, we have made progress. In record time, particularly European scientists have developed vaccines, the vaccine campaigns in Europe are in overdrive, and the decision that we Europeans decided to procure vaccines together remains the right decision. We Europeans, over and above that, have launched an unprecedented European recovery program with which we can offset both the economic and the social consequences of the pandemic, and beyond offering immediate assistance, we can also speed up Europe's transition to a climate-neutral and digital continent. That is one side of the coin, but the pandemic has also unsparingly uncovered Europe's weaknesses, Europe's shortcomings in our economies, and that is the other side of the coin. We have seen how vulnerable international supply chains can be. We saw bottlenecks in the supply of raw materials, metals, semiconductor products, and many other products, and that has very clearly impressed upon us how dependent we are in certain key technologies. Germany is still faring quite well. Our economy is recovering. It's on the path towards recovering. In Europe, it's going to take some time until economies are back on track and are strong again. And against this background, I think it's so important that you, in the Brussels Economic Forum, are going one step further, and you're demanding, and I quote, building the new economy we want. That is your aspiration. And I would even go further. I would go beyond the economy. Let us not only shape the new economy, but let us shape the Europe that we want, for this is about Europe's future. It's about how we want to live as Europeans in this world, how we want to work, how we want to do business in this world of tomorrow, and can we actually hold our own in this world of tomorrow. It is how we can actually bring our values, our interests, and our ideas of how globalization ought to be shaped to bear. As I see it, we need a more independent Europe, a Europe that can exercise actually self-determination, a more innovative Europe, and a more capable Europe than the Europe that we have right now. First, Europe needs to become more independent, needs to be able to determine its own fate and act accordingly. So let us take, for example, digital sovereignty. Becoming sovereign in the digital world doesn't mean to limit our cooperation with our partners. Rather, the contrary is true. We do not wish to set ourselves off against others or act in a protectionist manner. We commit ourselves to open markets, to a free, fair, and rules-based trade. Rather, do we wish to build on our strengths? We want to become better where we have shortcomings. And that means we also need to enhance our digital competences. In this way, we can also become an interesting business partner for others by working for more competences, for more sovereignty in key technologies, for example, in AI, hydrogen or quantum technologies. And in this way, we not only make Europe more resilient to crises, but we also create new opportunities for jobs, for growth, for social security. And this is a potential that we wish to tap together with our international partners. Second, Europe must become more innovative, and that means the foundation on which Europe's prosperity was built in the first place needs to be renewed time and time again. That's more important than ever, because even if the European Commission only recently confirmed that Europe is actually leading in a number of areas of technology, we still lag behind in such important areas as artificial intelligence, big data, or microelectronics. Unfortunately so. Research and innovation will give us the necessary impetus to close this gap and to be all the way at the top in research and innovation. Easier said than done, and it's certainly something new, because it was already at the beginning of this century that the European Union defined the goal to increase annual expenditure for research and development to 3% of GDP. But we must admit that we've only become closer to this goal, but we have not yet achieved it, and that needs to change. Third, Europe has to become more capable to act, and that means we have to deal sensibly with the scarce resources of time and money. Not only, but also in crises and times of crisis, the European Union must be better equipped to act faster and to take faster common decisions and to implement them, more so than in the past. And we also need to have the necessary leeway to take determined action in a spirit of solidarity. That means that we have to pursue sound fiscal policy in order to have the necessary freedom of maneuver to weather future crises. Ladies and gentlemen, a Europe that is more independent, more innovative, more capable to act than it is now. These challenges have already existed before the pandemic, but they have to become more visible and thus more pressing, more urgent. Let us only remind ourselves that Europe's share in the global population and also in the global economy in general has diminished over the years, and that has been the case for many years. Our role in the world is also changing, on the one hand between the United States and China, and then on the other hand also the way that we see ourselves as a globally responsible player. And the pandemic, in a way, is an additional warning. We need to work on our resilience to crisis, on our independence, on the way we determine our own fate, our innovation and future capacities. And that's what I wish from Europe and for Europe, for a Europe that in future too has to share and stand up for its values, its interests in a liberal democracy and based on the rule of law to the benefit of the people. Thank you.
Thank you, Chancellor Merkel, for sharing with us your vision. We are honored to have you with us today.